quorum being present, this town meeting is called to order. Please rise for the invocation to be given by Mr. Pacino.
Let us pray. We pray over the issues and the decisions we're to act on at these sessions. Before we start today is the Holocaust Remembrance Day. The day recognizes the liberation of the Dachau concentration camp and its satellite camps, plus the rescuing of hundreds of Jewish ethnicity camp inmates driven southward on a death march. We must always remember what happened during the Holocaust and the lessons learned from that time. As part of our civic duty, what happened during the Holocaust, we must be a caring and welcome people for all the people of our nation and our world. I also ask, what does giving our all mean? Do we give our all to our family and our neighbors? Do we give our all to others? I rhetorically ask, what does each of us do to make this world a better place? We may not live in a perfect world, but I remind all those here that as we pledge allegiance to the American flag, we should always remember what the flag stands for. America is a land of opportunity for all of us. Now on to what we are here to do tonight and the other nights as needed. We once again pray for wisdom, knowledge, understanding of the issues we are faced during these sessions. We pray for tolerance and respect. We ask for this for those whose thoughts and opinions we disagree with. We ask for those who disagree with our own thoughts and bridges. We should always build bridges of understanding, not walls against it. We should determine what is best for both the citizens of Reading and those affected beyond our borders. We ask for a clear picture of all the issues we face. By gaining that vision, we can apply the wisdom, the knowledge, and the understanding each of us has gained that we asked for earlier to the decisions we make. As I have done many times in the past, I remind all of us here that we should consider ourselves as a gathering together of friends here. My friends, many people ignore what we do here as unimportant and unnecessary. Some people just plain don't care. But every time we come here in this hall, each of us and all of us collectively must set aside the naysayers and just try for just and fair decisions that benefit all. Going forward from this hall, we should try to facilitate our decisions and avoid any distractions that may divert us from filling those decisions. And then again, with patience, some sacrifice, much perseverance, and with God's help, there will be a positive result arising from those decisions. Praise the Lord. God bless America. Amen.
Thank you. And now the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And now I'd like to ask our newly elected members and newly re-elected members to remain standing and raise your right hand, and we're going to swear you in. Repeat after me. I solemnly swear that I will faithfully and impartially discharge and perform all the duties incumbent on me as a town meeting member, according to the best of my ability and understanding, agreeable to the Constitution and laws of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and to the charter and bylaws of the town of Reading. So help me God. Congratulations, everyone, and welcome. All right, the clerk will now read the warrant.
To any of the constables of the town of Reading, greetings. In the name of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, you are hereby required to notify and warn the inhabitants of the town of Reading, qualified to vote in the local elections and town affairs, to meet in the following place designated for the 8 precincts in said town.
Mr. Arena moves that we dispense with the further reading. Is there a second? Second, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, then the motion carries.
By the virtue of this warrant, I, Thomas Friedman, on February 23rd, 2017, notified and warned the inhabitants of the town of Reading qualified to vote on town affairs to meet at the place and at the time specified by posting attested copies of the town meeting warrant in the following public places within the town of Reading. Precinct 1, Warren Killam School. Precinct 2, Reading Police Station. Precinct 3, Reading Municipal Light. Precinct 4, Joshua Eaton School. Precinct 5, Reading Public Library. Precinct 6, Barrow School. Precinct 7, Birch Meadow School. Precinct 8, Wood End School, and Town Hall. The date of the posting being not less than 14 days prior to April 4th, 2017, to the date set for town meeting in this warrant. I also caused the posting of this warrant to be published on the Town of Reading website on February 23rd, 2017.
Now, as is our tradition at the beginning of the annual meeting every April, the chair would like to remind town meeting members and inform newly elected members about some of the basic rules and how we will proceed. Number one, when recognized, please wait until you have the microphone before speaking. In addition to being heard in the hall, we want you to be heard on RCTV as well. The tapes from the cable cast may be used in verifying the official report. Two, before speaking, please state your name and precinct. Three, members are limited to no more than 10 minutes. The chair will call on people roughly in the order that they raise their hands, taking those who have not yet spoken first. Four, non-members may speak, but only after members have first had the opportunity to do so. Non-member proponents of a motion may speak with permission of the body. Number five, remember to stay away from personal attacks, or for the most part, personal references. We are here to discuss issues and not personalities. A couple of years ago, we instituted a new practice. We no longer read the motions, as all of you now have a printed copy. The only time we read it is if there is a change from what you have. The moderator instead declares that the motion has been made. We then call on the main proponent to open discussion. Then we hear relevant reports, financial articles reported on by the Finance Committee, bylaw changes by the bylaw committee, and so forth. Then we open debate to all members. After debate has proceeded for a while, we may have someone move the previous question or simply move the question. That is a call for debate to end. That motion itself is non-debatable, and we proceed directly to the issue of stopping debate. That takes a two-thirds vote. The chair will not recognize that motion from a person who has just spoken. In other words, if you want to move the question and stop debate, that must be the only thing you have risen for. Amendments. We may have people offer amendments to motions on the floor. These will be accepted. Once an amendment is proposed and seconded, we debate only the merits of the proposed amendment, not the main motion. When ready, we vote on the proposed amendment, then we return to debating on the main motion, either as it stood before the proposed amendment or as amended, depending on how the vote went. When proposing amendments, please provide them to the town clerk on an 8.5 by 11 sheet in order to get your wording correct. Town meeting members must be sitting in the lower portion of the hall if they want to be recognized as town meeting members and have their votes counted. Instructional motions. Article 3 is placed on the warrant by the Board of Selectmen and calls for instructional motions. These motions instruct various boards or individuals to do whatever the motion calls for. Technically, state law does not allow motions to be made when the subject matter does not first appear in the warrant, but we have always traditionally allowed them because they are non-binding. Our bylaws stipulate that all main motions, which these are on 8.5 by 11 sheet, containing nothing but the motion. Otherwise, they're likely to be lost. The chair will enforce that rule. In addition, I would ask that whenever practical, all such motions be presented to the moderator at the beginning of each night's session. At some convenient point, the chair will inform the body what intended instructional motions have been presented. This is done in fairness to those being instructed and deserves some semblance of notice, and to town meeting members who, when making a decision as to whether or not to adjourn for the evening, should know what business is still before them. Unlike all regular articles, members have no idea what type of instructional motions will be made. By the way, I do have two that I will talk about in just a minute. There's often confusion between two particular motions, indefinite postponement and tabling. Let me give you a brief explanation of the difference. Indefinite postponement is a motion asking that the body not vote for a particular motion during the life of this town meeting. Although it is thought not so much as a vote against a particular issue, but rather a postponement, the result is the same. Voting in favor of indefinite postponement has the same result as voting against the main motion. If indefinite postponement carries, the main motion is defeated. A motion to indefinitely postpone is debatable. Tabling, on the other hand, is used for another purpose altogether. Tabling temporarily puts a motion aside. It can be brought up again by anyone moving to take it from the table at any time before the meeting adjourns sine die. This motion is non-debatable, although the chair allows a brief explanation as to why the motion to table has been made. Adjournment. There are two types of adjournment. At the end of an evening, we adjourn to a time certain. Tonight, for instance, when we're done for the evening, we presumably will adjourn until Thursday. When we are done with the business of town meeting, we adjourn sine die, which translates to without day. In other words, the meeting is complete. Please use non-audible alarms for all your phones and other gadgets. And finally, I'd like to explain how things are likely to proceed over the next few hours and next few days. Tonight, we will lay Article 2 and 3 on the table and begin with Article 4, and then proceed as far as we can, skipping the budget, which is Article 16. We'll start again on Thursday evening and where we left off. On next Monday, we'll go back to Article 2 so we can hear the State of the Town address, and then we will proceed with the budget, which is Article 16. Once we complete that, we'll go back and work on whatever is left. All right, two instructional motions. Let me just quickly go over them so you have an idea what will be coming. We won't get to these until next Monday. One is, wrong one. Climate Advisory Committee proposes to an introduced, okay, here we are, move that the town meeting direct the Climate Advisory Committee to explore options and to draft a bylaw to ban single-use thin film plastic bags in Reading in accordance with similar practices across Massachusetts and in consultation with stakeholders in Reading. The proposed plastic bag ban shall be presented for consideration by the next subsequent town meeting. And the other, move that the Board of Selectmen, acting as park commissioners, enforce the conditions of the gift of the 11.5 acres of land, Memorial Park, as voted by town meeting under Article 6 of 1917 Annual Town Meeting, which in part states, but said land shall not be used as a playground for football, baseball, soccer, and kindred games, or any games that in their nature are hazardous or require fenced enclosures. Like I said, we'll get to those Monday night. And with that, I believe we are now ready to go. Business under Article 2. Mr. Arena moves that we lay Article 2 on the, excuse me. What? Is what? I'm sorry, excuse me 1 second. I missed one announcement. I'd like everybody here on time Thursday at 7:30. We have a special guest speaker. Now we'll move on to the business of town meeting. Article 2, Mr. Arena moves that we lay the substance of Article 2 on the table. Is there a second? Second, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, substance of Article 2 is laid on the table. Mr. Arena moves that we lay the substance of Article 3 on the table. Is there a second? Second, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. Business under Article 4, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. For town meeting members new to this, I'll describe capital as done in two steps. First, capital items need to be in a capital plan. Article 4 changes things in a capital plan, adds, subtracts, and changes some amounts. It does not authorize spending. That's in a different article, so just I want you to know that. So for Article 4, you could see in your warrant report there's an extensive amount of rearranging. I'll specifically go over the ones for FY17 and the current year and FY18. As you can see on the slide behind me, those are the items that we will vote on in the next article, Article 5, to be done immediately this fiscal year. We are reducing our capital spending by $150,000. Last fall, I announced that we would not proceed with the Killam Field and parking lot renovation, which had been budgeted for $350,000. There were two reasons. One was the failure of the override to pass meant we had to marshal our reserves. And the other was that the Killam School is in need of some sort of rehabilitation. And it struck me as foolish to rehab a field and then perhaps tear it up when there was a school renovation. So this project is now deferred, frankly, until a Killam School issue is resolved. There's two spending items on that. One is a summary of facilities projects detailed in your warrant report that are needed as repairs this year for $100,000. And the other is a cell tower design request for $100,000. The selectmen have had two different discussions, one of them very brief, on this is the Auburn Street Water Tower. This had been in the capital plan through the water enterprise fund to be significantly rehabbed at a great expense. As we went out to bid and learned some of the prices, we also learned that all the cell carriers that are on that would have to take all their equipment off, stage it at a very high location with a temporary structure, and then move it back. After a long discussion, literally for a year, with all the carriers in the room, which is pretty interesting, we decided to take two different steps. One is to design a cell tower that all the carriers could be on. This would authorize funding to design a cell tower. I don't think we quite need 100,000. I was quoted 75, so I think 100 is better. This will be a very public process. We have notified abutters and received comments so far that are all very positive. This would actually get the equipment a little bit higher and away from the water tank if it goes forward. So again, there'll be a very public process to follow once a cell tower or two designs are put forward. This would mean that in the future work on the water tower is independent of cell towers. This would be a structure that, frankly, we can do this either way. I think the best economics is for the town to design it and build it, and then the town to collect all the lease payments for it. The break even of that will be about 3 to 5 years, depending on how things shake out. If the cell tower companies would be delighted to design this and build this themselves, if they could get a much cheaper lease. I think it's in the best interest in the town to control this. This is our land. After a couple years, this will well more than pay for itself. Separately, the water tank will be discussed in the future, and I think it's written up slightly in your budget book. We're thinking of tearing down the water tank and putting in a new one that does not ever need to be painted again. I wanted to do transparent and put fish in there, but I was shouted down on that one. So both of those items are necessary in the short run, and again, we're saving money all in all. The second item behind me for the enterprise funds is for the sewer station rehab. We're asking for $200,000. When I asked for this, I wasn't sure if we needed it today. I was told it's very unlikely that we'll need it. I would still prefer to ask for it. If it is not used on June 30th, it just goes right back to sewer reserves. So there was some unanticipated groundwater at one of the stations by Batch Elder, and it's caused the project to be a little delayed and a little more expensive than we thought. So I'd just soon go ahead with that. I won't go over all of these, but you can see that FY18, which will be the budget discussion next Monday, there's a significant amount of capital that moved. I'll mention some of the highlights. The first two items in the general fund, the fire breathing apparatus and the DPW truck, I would rank as urgent for different reasons. The permanent building committee, who will speak at one of these articles either tonight or Thursday, has requested annual funding so that they can do some of their work. We're able to fund that through the capital plan at $150,000. 100 to 150 seems a reasonable area. There is no specific project or projects they're looking at, but they will definitely come along. If they don't, they return this to free cash. This is to complete a flyover. We did a regional flyover a year ago, actually it was a year and a half ago, and saved somewhere between $50,000 and $75,000 by partnering with other communities. We're now in a position to finish the work and ask for money to do the planometrics. At the bottom of the list, you can see we deferred or reduced over $800,000 worth of capital. Town meeting members that were here last fall recall that to settle the high school litigation, we used a big chunk of free cash. We also used some debt. We needed to shrink our capital plan in order to allow for the debt service for the high school litigation, so this does that. I won't go into as much detail on the enterprise funds, although I will on Monday night. There's some moving around also within those funds.
At our meeting on March 22nd, 2017, the Finance Committee voted 9-0-0 in support of the article.
Is there further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 5. Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This vote spends money. As you can see, there's quite a number of adjustments that are made in the budget. The driver behind that is a lot of the line items, if you will, on the town side are individual lines. The school department has bottom line authority. They don't need to make quite as many adjustments. We make them twice a year at November town meeting and then annual. Again, I'll hit some high spots. Last November, we reduced the amount of health insurance premiums. We're able to do that once again. The town saved over $300,000 this year by paying people not to take health insurance. It's like farmers not farming. The town has, over the 4 years, saved about $1.1 million and paid out to employees about 25% of that and retained savings of over $800,000. So it's been certainly a very lucrative thing. From a budget standpoint, though, I've started to budget that some of those are going to keep staying away, but it could be a risky thing if they all return. I think I mentioned last November the retirement assessment was a little bit too high for the current year, so it can be reduced. I just described $150,000 reduction in capital. We had less enrollment in the Volk schools. There's a number of relatively small items in the administrative services you can see behind me. One thing I should note is the pay in class funding. There was 93,000 remaining. We are moving 70-odd thousand around to other departments, and we are going to not use 23,000, which is what you see behind you. We're asking for an increase in town council and special counsel. Part of that was TLT work that town council and special counsel did. We're also needing to hire a special counsel for cable negotiations, which is due in 2 years from next fall. So we want to get that process started before June 30th. We hired an economic development director, although not well into the fiscal year, so we didn't need quite as many wages budget as were budgeted, and we're reducing some of the offsets. I'll show you that shortly. We also had a community services director depart last fall. We have cut the position from the budget next year. We did not fill it this year, so a lot of those wages were also available. In public safety, we had a number of very senior, it's another word for old, employees retire. Our employees, union and non-union, have a cutoff of higher date where they're eligible for sick leave buyback. People hired 20 years ago or more are still eligible. The maximum payout is 100 days at 50% times your retirement wage. So in some cases in police and fire, it's in the $20,000 area each. We also had a couple of expenses requested for public safety, but we did not regionalize animal control with a certain neighbor to our north. We're now talking to one to our east. So we have some surplus funding. Highway fuel had a nice surplus this year. We've reduced it in the budget next year. For the first time in quite some time, almost 10 years, however, highway outsource repairs did go up. That's a line that when I was on the finance committee 10 or 15 years ago was chronically under budgeted because our capital plan was so deficient. It's interesting that this year we just happen to have a lot of expensive repairs that we had to outsource. If it doesn't snow anymore, this number should be fine. 250,000, I was sure 150,000 would be fine, and then we had a snowstorm in April. We have a little bit of a savings in street lights. We have an accounting issue, I guess I would call it, or not issue, but item in line M91 facilities. We had changed at November town meeting a security system evaluation consulting study to be capital instead of an expense. Our town accountant has let that money, if you will, go to free cash and now asks you to take free cash and put it into the capital plan. So it's just an accounting, I better not say game, it's an accounting issue. Dr. Doherty is here. If there's any discussion, there's also a request from the school committee for $150,000 for phase two of science curriculum materials. The long and short of all this, even with an overrun in snow and ice of $250,000, we're only using $320,000 from free cash, which is pretty good. We're also depleting the sick leave stabilization fund. There's a whole $30.78 Town Accountant Sharon Angstrom will describe that a little bit later. This is that $200,000 capital item that I requested under Article 4. This would be from sewer reserves. Again, if it's not used, and we anticipate it will not or not much, it'll go right back to the reserves on June 30th.
FinCom report, Mr. Leidecker.
At the FinCom meeting on March 22nd, the Finance Committee voted 9-0 with no abstentions to recommend this article to town meeting.
Is there further discussion? Yes, Mr. Mon.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. I have a question on the G92 administrative service expenses, which is on page 6 of 7, but I think they're all page 6 of 7.
Okay.
No, G92, not H92.
On the top.
There we go.
Yeah.
The town council increase of $50,000, what does that bring the total town council budget to for the year?
Next year we're budgeting $200,000. This year we had budgeted $160,000, so I'm going to say that brought it to $210,000 for the year.
$200,000 or $300,000?
$210,000 for just town council, not legal services, because there's other pieces.
So how does that compare to previous years? Seems like a pretty high number, $210,000. And the reason I paid attention to it, I seem to see more and more that we go to town council than we have in the past.
Certainly, in FY15, as you can see in the budget, $265,000 just for town council. In FY16, $160,000. So the $210,000 is sort of in between that. I don't remember the exact number, but I'm going to say somewhere between $25,000 and $50,000 of that was TLT related town council expenses, which I'll describe as one time. Every couple of months with the selectmen, I review the legal sort of budget. We are asking town council for a lot more because the town is very busy. At one point, I think even now, we have 5 active 40B projects that requires town council's oversight. So there's just a lot going on right now.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Crook.
Stephen Crook. Is this on? Okay, Stephen Crook, Precinct 2. Question, what's the FY18 budget for special counsel for cable?
There is no FY18 budget. We're requesting the funds tonight as part of an FY17 budget. Then the town accountant will allow us, if we hire someone, to carry that money into next year to pay special counsel as they work.
So that covers the entire cost?
Yes.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, right at the back.
Tom Grant, Lothrop Road. Yeah, you already commented on the police vacation, J91. You commented on the police vacation sick buyback and the fire vacation sick buyback. By the way, I like the background music. Thank you. That's good. No, I want more of it. So it's a significant number this year, and I think you attribute it mainly to retirements. Is this going to be an ongoing issue? Because that is quite a significant increase in just this budget. I'd like to not see it happen again if we could.
It's a complicated answer. In general, sick leave buyback, when it happens, sometimes can be absorbed by a department, sometimes cannot. Public safety is generally the hardest one because they have overtime pressures. At some point, this goes away. It won't go away for another 5 to 10 years anyways. I'll broadly explain that our police department starting, I'm going to say between 5 and 10 years ago, started to go through a major transition. A lot of long-standing, long-employed police officers retired. They are now very close to the tail end of that process, with all due respect to the few that's left. Our fire department is probably 5 years behind that. They've just started that process over the last 3 to 5 years. So it's this wave of lots of retirees. And when I say long-standing employees, I mean 30 to 40-year employees, not 10-year. So there is another wave that will continue, especially in fire, for the next 5 years or 7 years. And then it'll be done. Some years you haven't seen this number at all because there's been surplus overtime funding that could pay for it. This year there wasn't enough. As you can see, we had a very difficult year in the fire department for injuries and are requesting additional overtime. I should also explain, as I explained to FinCom, in public safety at this time of year, we like to add $50,000 to $75,000 more than we think we'll need. If we don't use it, it goes back to free cash. If we need it, we can't not have police and fire work when they need to work. So that's the hope. Although this year, I'm not sure we'll have that much surplus. I hope that explains it.
Yes, thank you very much.
Further discussion? Yes.
Cynthia Cole, Precinct 6. C99, please. The service cell tower design, how is $100,000 being saved on that plan?
Would you mind repeating the last sentence?
The cell tower design, how is the $100,000 being saved on that plan?
Well, I'm asking to spend $100,000 in order to design a cell tower. The design and then the construction, if we go through with construction, will end up costing, let's roughly say, $350,000. And then on the other side of that, there'll be annual revenues that are to be negotiated. We're a little bit below market right now, getting $50,000 to $60,000 a year in lease payments. We have one vendor that is not currently on the water tower because there's no space. We'll be able to add them if we go through with this project. So over time, that $350,000 over, let's just say, 5 years should be repaid. But there's no money sort of coming from nowhere in the short run. It'll be, you know, more money in 3 to 5 years.
And how is the new tower different from the tower that's already there?
Right now there is no tower. There's just, well, there's a water tower. And on top of the water tower is a bunch of antennas. It's not a particularly safe arrangement. Is anyone here from OSHA? It's not at all safe. it's really something that, as time went along, more carriers wanted to get up there. The town technically cannot forbid carriers from going up there other than for reasons of safety. The town did allow them up there, so they're just strung along the top of a water tower right now. This would be a standalone structure. You know, we've had some interesting suggestions on design. Reading Rocket is certainly one of them.
Okay,
Cactus,
so,
no.
So these are receiving towers and not transmitting towers, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, so
And importantly, our police, fire, and regional police fire agencies will also be in the top of that tower. I don't want to mention a carrier's name, but there's some very poor coverage in Reading, and there are areas in the town, including this building, that coverage for public safety is not great, and this will fix that.
Okay, so I don't think when we passed all of the cell tower, all these cell tower plans in our, I know we passed legislation on that recently, that it wasn't investigated thoroughly before cell tower planning was actually approved to be implemented in the manner that it was presented in the plan. So I have some concerns about microwave radiation. And I'm just concerned about the amount of radiation that will be going towards that area and whether there are any residential areas in that vicinity. Other than the water tank, what else is out there?
There are abutters. There are immediate abutters. Actually, the design we're imagining removes the structures further away from the houses, so it should improve the situation.
It should, but I mean, I think people really ought to look up Magda Havas, H-A-V-A-S. She is a professor out of Canada. And she she is very up to date on cell phone communication towers. And she has a lot to say about these towers and the problematic, there's a lot of problems with the amount of radiation going in and out of those towers. And people just don't understand because they're invisible that they can't cause any immediate danger. But there have been multiple studies on this. So, I mean, we're talking about people's home values decreasing if the towers come in and there's too much radiation in that area. I really think this needs to go further into investigation before you assign someone who probably doesn't know the actual, they're just going to design it for you as you request. They probably aren't going to conduct a safety survey at that time.
If you're interested in the information that we have and the models we've used, look on the Town of Bedford's website. They're just in the process of building a new cell tower themselves for a very similar reason as us. They have a lot of research, and you know, we've relied on their work as
Town
being independent.
Bedford?
Bedford.
Cell tower, it's online?
Yes.
Is it too late to ask the public health people to take a look at the amount of radiation going in and out of these towers before this is done?
That's up to you. It's up to the body.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Further discussion? Yes, right on the edge.
Steve Herrick, Precinct 8. Bob, I assume that this is cell towers going up on town land, so there's no expense associated with that. But I'm curious, we're just paying for the design right now. Is there money allocated in the capital budget? What's the timing on this, and how would you plan on funding this? I'm just curious. This is kind of the first bite of the apple. I'm assuming there's
right.
more down the road. If it's only, if it's $100,000 to design, and I'm assuming it's a lot more to actually build it.
Yeah.
Shades it a little differently.
We have an
negative.
Estimate of $250,000 to build, so $350,000 total. Who knows? In theory, we could have just done this with money that's already in the Water Enterprise Fund that was designed for repair of the water tank. It seemed to me that a cell tower is something that generates a lease payment that's in the general fund, and we should do work related to it and pay for it in the general fund.
So
it is on town land. We would absolutely isolate in a very secure way the land that the cell tower's on versus the land the water's tower's on. It's a little bit unnerving to have vendors climbing all over our water structure from a security standpoint, and this would stop that. So there's no cost associated with land. We've got that. You know, this is the better way to pay for it, I think, through the general fund.
And your payback estimate includes our current estimation, the entire cost of the project, not just...
Correct.
Let's see, I saw another hand over here. No? Read the discussion? Okay. On the other side?
George Vita, Precinct 2. I have a question about the cost related to the Bedford installation. Do we know what they are, or are we kind of speculating that it's going to be $350 or around that?
The last we talked to them in February, so I haven't talked to them since. They were around the $350,000 cost all in also, as we are using tonight.
Okay, so we are using their numbers
yes.
to kind of project this.
Correct.
Okay. Further discussion? Mm-hmm. And appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 6. Ms. Angstrom.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The purpose of this article is to approve prior year bills. We only have one. It's for Callback Staffing Solutions for $90.72. This vendor chose to send their bills by email, and somehow this bill got filtered into junk mail. So we didn't learn about it until January when they notified us the bill remained outstanding.
FinCom report, Mr. Leidegger.
At the FinCom meeting held on March 22nd, we voted 9-0 with no abstentions to recommend this article. It really is something that relates to the prior year, and so we really don't have a lot of choice on that. So.
Is there further discussion? None appearing. This requires a four-fifths vote. Let me explain something about how we operate on a regular majority vote, I always take a show of hands. Anything above that, we normally have a standing count. But if in a case where I haven't heard any opposition, I try a hand count first. If it's not unanimous, then we go to a standing count. But if you feel like you have to vote against it, don't let that scare you. Just vote against it. But all those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And the motion carries unanimously. Business under Article 7. Ms. Angstrom.
Okay. Purpose of this article is to approve the disposition of surplus property. We have 16 assets in total, and the slide here shows the first 9 assets with estimated values between $500 and $40,000. This second slide shows the remaining 7 assets with estimated values between $100 and $500. Approval of this article will allow the town to sell, exchange, or dispose of these assets accordingly.
FinCom report, Mr. Burkhart.
At our meeting on March 22nd, 2017, the Finance Committee voted 9-0 with no abstentions to recommend the article to town meeting.
Is there further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 8, Ms. Angstrom. Okay.
This article has 2 purposes. The first is to accept the amended law that was accepted back in 2012 to create our OPEB trust fund. In 2016, legislation was passed to amend and provide more clarity about that trust fund. And so by approving this article tonight, we would accept that section of the law as amended so that our trust fund, our existing trust fund, would now fall under that legal structure. And the second purpose of this article is to do the routine transfer of the OPEB contributions that were a part of the fiscal 17 budget. We usually do those in April. And, sorry, they're listed on the slide behind me. So it's $576,000. $500,000 is from the general fund, $50,000 from the water, $20,000 from sewer, and $6,000 from the stormwater fund.
FinCom report, Ms. Alvarado.
At the meeting on March 22nd, 2017, the Finance Committee voted 9-0-0 to recommend this article to town meeting.
Further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 10, Mr. LaLasha.
I think it's 9, Mr. Moderator. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. On page 9 of your warrant report, I wrote some background for last November. A half dozen town meeting members had come up to me after the meeting and were a little bit confused as to what happened or what didn't happen. I hope that the explanation about what didn't happen last November is clear. Effectively, town meeting passed Article 15. Town meeting did not pass, nor did they care to reconsider Article 16. This article in front of you is one piece of what Article 16 was. And if you will, as opposed to authorizing to sell the land, this is a housekeeping issue. This is a request to declare by accepting reports from all public committees, in this case only the school committee has come forward, that it's no longer needed for a public purpose. The school committee made such a vote twice in the last 10 years. This step will then allow the selectmen to advertise the property as for sale and have developers come in and make proposals. Right now, there is no specific plans. There had been someone interested last fall. They are not anymore. I have no idea what the parcel may go for. If this article is not approved, it makes the selectmen's job substantially more difficult to market the parcel to anyone. They won't look at it. Some of them won't look at it. Again, we have no idea what use would happen. But as I said last November, the selectmen must come with a fully public process because they have to ask your permission eventually to dispose of the land, and they have to explain exactly what the purpose is. So you can rest assured it will be a very public process because there's no other way this is going to work. Right now there is no time frame on it. If this article is approved tonight, I would assume that we'll start advertising the property, you know, with our economic development folks and see what's out there.
FinCom report, Mr. Doxer.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. At our meeting of March 22nd, 2017, FinCom voted 9-0-0 to recommend this article.
Further discussion, Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Bill Brown, my favorite subject at town meeting. For how many years, Bob?
Almost 50.
Pretty close. Basically, I think you're talking about the 2,100 square feet that the school department owns, Bob, I'm sure. Do you have the map of the, did you bring the map a chance?
I did not.
Okay, I can do it anyways, that's all right. I'm going to give you a little history of that 2,100 square feet so you know what we're talking about tonight. This was taken as part of land 83 years ago, 1934, from a gentleman named Landers. And I know town council is going to disagree with me, but that's all right. We've had that before. And for non-payment of taxes, recorded in the South Middlesex Registry of Deeds, and it was bound by what was Glenview Road on the west side, on the east side, on the west by Oakland Road, approximately 100 feet into what is the present parking lot of the property, high school property.
Bill, is this the map?
Okay, thanks, Bob. Yeah, you'll see just a little sliver up there. I think it's 2,100 square feet, Bob. I don't know if you can see it. Yeah, right. Back further, right about there, yeah. That 2,100 square feet is still under the jurisdiction of the Board of the School Committee. And why it came about, I'm going to tell you in a minute. Article 2 of 1937 town meeting authorized the Board of Selectmen to sell on such terms and conditions they may determine any and all real estate now or hereafter, and I want to repeat that, now or hereafter, acquired by the town for tax property, which this was. In 1947, town meeting approved the taking of land by eminent domain and dedicated other town-owned property, a 100-foot strip of the original 1934 Landers taking on the west side of Oakland Road for school use. In 1954, Oakland Road, as we know it today, was laid out with part of the Landers land of 1934 taking from the school side to increase the roadway from 40 feet to 50 feet. And as you know, Oakland Road took a southerly turn up to Dan Ensminger's house to connect with Parkview, and that's the 2,100 square feet we're talking about. In 1956, laying out of Birch Meadow, more of the Landers land was taken. In 1984, more of the Landers land was sold to the Housing Authority for $1 at Waverly and Oakland Road under an instructional motion of town meeting after town council ruled at that time that it was not needed and that the 1937 town meeting vote still. In my opinion, given the history of the Board of Selectmen can sell this remaining Landers land without a further vote of town meeting. And that was based on the 1937 town report. I know town council and I are going to disagree, but that's all right. He has a right to be wrong.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Pacino.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Phil Pacino, Precinct 5. I think it's very nice that the Finance Committee voted 9-0, but I'd like to know the reasons why they voted 9-0 for this, if they would get up, please.
Do we have a response? Mr. Doctor.
I believe that this came up, how many years ago, 3 or 4? Yeah, we went through a process looking at that parcel. The only reason the Finance Committee voted is that it could involve a financial transaction at some point. It's been deemed surplus. This is the second time it's come around. We just had a formal vote to state we believe this is the right use for it.
Yes. Young.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Megan Young, Precinct 4. Bob, I just needed a clarification. It says here, Article 16 authorizes the Board of Selectmen to sell or otherwise dispose of land. So are we voting to let them do that right now, or are they coming back? Which is it?
Last November, Article 16 had two parts listed on page 9. Tonight is only the first part. Tonight has nothing to do with that second part. There is no authorization to sell. That would require a future vote of town meeting, presumably with some sort of proposal in front of it.
So we, in this, we just are authorizing them to start a public process.
Exactly.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Mr. Mon.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. I guess I'm a little confused now. Is the parcel we're talking about the 2,100 square feet, or that entire shaded area on the map?
In Mr. Brown's mind, it's smaller. It's the entire shaded map. Anyone who might own title to that, school committee or anyone else, that's what this vote will declare.
And approximately how many acres is it?
Oh, I don't know. I just don't know, Jamie.
It looks like perhaps 15 or 20 housing parcels?
We looked at this maybe 15 years ago from the Finance Committee, 157,000 square feet. At a time, it was possible that three units of cluster housing of four units each could fit in there. I don't have any idea if housing is the right use for this parcel. That's what a public process will result in.
But if it's approximately 160,000, so that's approximately 4 acres.
Okay.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Mr. Graham?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Russ Graham, Precinct 4. Mr. Brown and I have been debating this sale of land for more years. Neither of us want to think about it. But considering what we pay town council, I guess we ought to put them to work. Do you, in fact, disagree with Mr. Brown? And if you do, why? Thank you.
Mr. Meares.
I would never presume to disagree with Mr. Brown. So we know that that sliver has been under the care, custody, and control of the school department. What we don't know is who has care, custody, and control of the rest of it. So the reason we're transferring it all to the Board of Selectmen is so that we can answer the question, who has care, custody, and control of the entire parcel? It will be, if this passes, it will be the Board of Selectmen. Then the Board of Selectmen will be in a position to figure out what the best use of the property will be. But we were never able to pin down any old town meeting vote specifying the care, custody, and control of the rest of the parcel.
Further discussion? Yes, on the far left, my far right.
John Weston, Precinct 7. Can you describe the process you see? You talk about a public process. What does that public process look like?
It's not really appropriate for me to speak for the board, but I will. Normally, the board would notify abutters and have abutter neighborhood meetings to discuss types of use of a parcel. It's unusual because it's town land. Usually, it's someone else's land, and we're kind of on the outside. For instance, if it's a 40B, this is what's going to happen, and we get the neighbors involved. In this case, where we own the land, it would be our responsibility to sit down with the neighbors a couple of times and talk to them. And the neighbors don't mean just immediate abutters. It could mean anyone that wants to come to public meetings. So I would presume that we would start with that, having no idea what the market may, you know, offer.
I thought I heard you say something about putting out a proposal to try and get
We would do that after the after a first set of initial meetings, absolutely. I would assume we would do that.
That's a very different process than having a public process, because that means it would be private entities that would be coming back to us. So our what we would be seeing is a private development to dispose of the property, not necessarily a public process on what the highest and best use for
I don't actually agree with that. If the public process up front yields something that we absolutely should not consider, for instance, then we would put it in an RFP saying, don't do this. If a process yields, please do this, we might say, please emphasize that. But whatever the results of an RFP will be in the public domain.
I guess the clarification is, would we have the public process first before you put something out?
We would have it first, and then we would have it afterwards before any decisions are made.
All right, thank you.
Yes. Ready? Yes. Ms. O'Neill.
Mary Ellen O'Neill, Precinct 4. I am going to vote against this, and I wish I would like other members of town meeting to do the same. The assumption here is that this will be sold. I'm of the opinion that it should remain as it is, and I also believe that at this point, the only way we should build is up and not stop clearing land. Once it's cleared, it will never go back. And I know in my neighborhood over the last 25 years, we've probably lost a third to a half of the private tree cover. There's nothing that we can do from the town side as we've lost our shade tree nursery and, you know, less and less tree planting over the years to make up for that. I would like to see this stay the same. So if we vote for this, we're actually voting for the selectmen to go ahead and make some arrangements to sell it for whatever purpose. So I will vote against this. Thank you.
Mr. LaLasha.
Just to be clear, you certainly have every right to do that, but the selectmen have no right to sell the property without further discussion with this body. There won't be any private arrangements to do anything in secret.
Yes.
Hi, Mary Ann Downing, Precinct 3. Two questions, and maybe this came up in the fall and I missed it. Have we ever had the property appraised to see what it's worth? And second, this is probably a question for town council. I don't know what the property looks like. Are there any adverse possession issues with the neighbors that they might try to lay claim to something that they've been, you know, has the town actively been going through the property, or is it just maybe neighbors are doing something and they're going to lay claim to some part of it? Thank you.
Mr. Meares.
Well, America's a free country and people can file lawsuits alleging a whole lot of things. I have never heard anyone suggest that that they have a claim against the town. But that doesn't mean that there isn't somebody out there who suggests. The general rule of thumb, however, is that you can't have adverse possession against the town as long as it's holding the property for a municipal governmental function. So since they're basically holding it as open space, I would say that qualifies, and the rule would be that there can't be adverse possession against the town. That's the general rule. I can't speculate about what clever lawyer might come up with to work around that, but I think it's a fairly safe assumption that that we're good on that score.
Mr. LaLasha.
On the other part of your question, the school department 3 or 4 years ago looked at building an all-day early education center in the area. They looked at this parcel. They looked across the street in the parking lot near the Performing Arts Center and then put parking across the street. They did a lot of geotechnical work to understand what the site looked at. I don't believe there was any reason for them to ever do an appraisal, and I know we haven't, so I don't think there's ever been an actual appraisal. There would be no sense in appraising land that we don't have clear title to, I suppose, is the way I would look at it.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Herrick.
Steve Herrick, Precinct 8. Just how is this land zoned right now?
I assume it's residential. I don't know if it's 20. You think it's S15? Okay.
And up on the aisle, yes.
Jeffrey Parham,
Precinct 7. I'm an abutter, actually. I walked through that property to get here this evening. and I will note, in response to the previous question, there is a fair bit of a steep a hill kind of to the left side and a fairly deep ravine off to the right side that would make it difficult to build without doing some substantial rework of the landscape there. I was also a little concerned with the description that as soon as this gets transferred to the selectmen that you would immediately, that in your initial description, you would immediately solicit proposals for selling it. It sounded like in your clarification to the other speaker across, you said, no, we'll have a public process to think about what else we might do. I think that came up in November's subsequent town meeting, that town was interested in at least thinking about what other things we might want to do with that open space.
Mr. Berman?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Barry Berman, Precinct 6. There seems to be kind of some suspicion around kind of that there's a nefarious plan that the Board of Selectmen has to do something with this land. Let me assure you that there is none. I think everybody could agree that that land is not at its highest and best use right now, unless you think highest and best use is a repository for empty beer bottles and old tires. Before we can even begin the discussion in terms of what we want to do with this, we actually has to be declared surplus, and then we'll begin that process. The end result is not known. It could be, as Mrs. O'Neill states, left open. That is a potential use that comes at the end of a public process. We can't even begin to have that conversation or that process unless this article is passed so that it's now declared surplus so that we can at least figure out what it is we want to do with it. Maybe it gets sold. Maybe it gets held. Maybe there's a public use for it. That's a great conversation to have. That conversation can't happen unless Article 9 passes. So I encourage you to vote yes. Thank you.
Yes. Next one, right behind you. Yes.
Hello, Nicholas Worth, Precinct 7, and I'm familiar with the space and would like to see it eventually cleared out, groomed, and perhaps turned into a park. Would there be any capacity to do this if this motion failed? Or is it in a limbo that we would not be able to do that sort of thing with that?
No, we really need to take this step first.
All right, thank you very much.
Who haven't spoken yet? Yes, in the back. Yes.
Jennifer Hillary, Precinct 7. I am supporting this article for the reasons stating by Selectman Berman. I do feel that it's proper for our Board of Selectmen to explore the options available to us with this piece of property. I would like clarification, however, on the last phrase in the article, the semicolon, or take any other action with respect thereto. To me, that seems to include the sale, which I know the intent is not for the Board of Selectmen to initiate a sale at this time, but if Town Council might offer clarification about what that's referring to.
You can do part. I've put the motion up behind me. I don't know if you can see it, but those words are not in the motion. Those words are typically added by Town Council to every article so that we can add to the discussion on the floor. But there is no words in the motion that will say, and we might do something else with it we didn't tell you about.
I apologize. No, thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, in the back, yes.
Hi, Heather Klisch, Precinct 7. I don't think there's anything nefarious going on, but I do have a question. Part of the motion is also, I believe, I'm just wondering if I'm reading this correctly. I believe part of the motion is to also accept a report and declaring that it's no longer required for public purposes. So I guess I'm just wondering, you know, does that close the door inadvertently if in a process the town decides, hey, actually part of it or all of it could be used for a park, which would be a public purpose. What's the relationship there?
This absolutely does not close that door. What this does is it solicited anyone that's in the public domain that might hold rights to this, such as the school committee, recreation committee, whoever might come forward. As town council said, after a pretty exhaustive research in the deed in Cambridge and through town meeting minutes, there was just no clear answer except in Bill Brown's head as to what's going on here. So it just allowed anyone to come forward to give a report and to declare whether they did or did not have a public purpose. If this article passes, the town through the selectman absolutely has a right to use it as a public purpose.
Mr. Mon?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jamie Mon, Precinct 4. I would like to encourage the selectmen that after this public process, if multiple proposals are brought forward, that those multiple proposals are brought to town meeting, and that the Board of Selectmen doesn't listen to the public process, select one proposal and bring that up or down to town meeting, but rather give us a chance to discuss the options of a public park, school parking, 40B housing, or whatever else arises from the public process, and give us options. Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, Ms. Lloyd.
Patricia Lloyd, Precinct 8. My concern is that I don't see any other committees here, any other of the town public bodies here to issue a report. Was, for example, the Conservation Commission or the Climate Change Committee personally invited to come down and have a report? My other concern is that from what I've seen reading through the materials, public purpose only seems to include whether or not a building could be sited on this, and open space should be considered as a public purpose. If this information, if the introductory clause is only an invitation for people to speak and not a declaration that we are now deciding two things. One, whether there is in fact no public purpose, or two, transferring the vote. I would like, if that's true, in either way, I would like to move to delete from the first half of the sentence, move to hear the report through is no longer required for public purposes, because I'm very uncomfortable with town meeting at this point making a decision that the land is in fact no longer required for public purposes. Can I make that
motion? So what is your motion exactly, so we get it?
To delete, move to hear the report through the first four lines ending for public purposes. I guess we would leave move in there, move to see if the town will vote.
Okay, yeah, I have to leave the word.
I don't understand why, you know, the town should have to, why the town meeting should be asked to declare whether or not it's required for public purposes. But first, I mean, also, I would like an answer to whether the other committees were invited to appear tonight and give reports.
I can
first
answer that.
We have
part.
A second to that motion.
Sorry.
Second? Second, okay. Mr. Lashen?
Just to be clear, this is only to establish who has title to the land, not what their opinions are of what the land should be used for. So this was asking anyone that had title claiming ability to come forth and give this body a report. Only the school committee has done that. Only the school committee believes that they have any title rights. All boards and committees were notified by the Warren article itself. Through our work, we had no records. Sometimes it quite often would say Town of Reading was the owner. Normally, when it says Town of Reading and it's, for instance, conservation, there's some indication of that. But nonetheless, we showed it to the boards that may own land. None of them had any claim to the title. So again, this is not use of land at all. It's just who owns the land. If you think you own it, please come and tell town meeting, and only the school committee has done so. And I'll let town council answer the second part of your question.
Mr. Meharis?
So the statute that requires town meeting approval to transfer the care, custody, and control of land from one board to another requires that the board that is giving up care, custody, and control make a finding that it's not needed for one of their public purposes. So the school committee did that. That's the easy part. The rest of it, we don't know. So we, the care, custody, and control might, in fact, already be in the Board of Selectmen. But the, no, but the best we can do is say no one has claimed there to be a public purpose within their jurisdiction for which they have care, custody, and control. So it's a statutory prerequisite to the transfer. So if you remove the first half, then you can't do the second half.
I understand, and I'll withdraw my motion.
Okay, is there any objection with her withdrawing the motion? None. Okay, we will return to discussion on the main motion. Further discussion? Yes, Mr. O'Neill.
John O'Neill, Precinct 4. As I recall from our discussions in November around this, one of the impetuses behind it was, in fact, the town's desperate financial situation. And so the reason why it was brought at this time, because that property's been there, you know, for a long time, and we did, was considered relative to the early intervention, early education center. Not that that's a negative, but in fact, that should be out front, you know, because at that time too, as I recall, it was indicated there were some exciting possibilities. So it's not like this was just wide open, didn't have any idea, it's a simple transfer to allow the process to begin. I'm not saying that's a reason to oppose it, but I think we should be very open about all aspects of what we're talking about.
Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. For the benefit of newer town meeting members, I should have added that this body declared this property as surplus in 2012. That's in the write-up. Town council came along and said what was done many years ago was not legally sufficient. The reason we waited till last fall, first of all, government works very slowly, was because the school department was looking at the parcel. So it was foolish for us to go forward and do any of this work if the school department was going to build an early education center. When that failed, we started working on this, what you see in front of you. Last November, town meeting did clear up all the paper streets, if you will. This is part two of three to clear up the title. So there is a background to this property. Mr. O'Neill is correct. The financial needs of the town are great, and you'll see a little bit more of that Monday. There was two interested parties in a joint venture last fall that are no longer interested, so it was exciting. It's no longer exciting. They would have just been in line with any other possible use in a public process, and maybe they'll one or more of them will come forward again. But you know, there's no urgency in the sense that someone is tapping on our shoulder and saying we need to buy this. There's perhaps an urgency to either put the property on the tax rolls or to get some money in the sale of real estate fund, I suppose. But a public process, I think, has to come first.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Bill Brown, Precinct 4. I'm Precinct 8. Sorry, I came in Precinct 4 many years ago. I think there's one thing that we should think of about this for public purposes. The Board of Selectmen own it. We are always behind the ball on 40B housing. Wouldn't it be nice to be able to be in the driver's seat and say, we have a piece of property we can offer to you for 40B housing. And if I'm correct, under the bidding laws, we can even offer them an incentive for less money than we would normally get from anybody else. We could solve some of our 40B problem friendly instead of agitated as we mostly do. And I know that this has been around, I think, 50 years that I've been here anyways, and it'll probably be 50 years later, and I won't be here, I hope. But I think it's time to act on it. Give the selectmen the authority to start looking at it. I am 100% certain, and I know town council will disagree with me, but it is tax title property taken in 1934, and the Board of Selectmen have the right to sell tax property.
Further discussion? Yes. Mr. O'Sullivan?
Patrick O'Sullivan, Precinct 5. I'd like to move the question.
Move the question? Is there a second? Second. This requires a two-thirds vote. Let's see, I will have to have some counters. Mr. Brown, will you take the right plus the Finance Committee? Mr. Crook, will you take the your side of the center? And Mr. Rushworth, will you take your side of the center? And Ms. Russell, would you like to take the left and the Board of Selectmen?
Mr. Moderator, you might want to explain this process.
Yes. What this is a vote to end debate. It's not debatable itself, but it requires a two-thirds vote. So if you vote yes for this, you are ending debate. So all those in favor of ending debate, please rise. Mr. Crook?
26.
26.
42.
42. 28. All those opposed to ending debate, please rise.
One.
One.
Ten.
Four.
Four.
Fifteen. The vote being 122 in the affirmative and 30 in the negative, the motion carries and debate is ended. We will now move to the question, which also requires a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of the motion, please rise. Thirty-two.
24.
24.
36.
36. 31. And those opposed?
Five.
Three.
Three.
Ten. 12. The vote being 123 in the affirmative, 30 in the negative, the motion carries. Business under Article 10. Table this. Mr. Arena moves that we lay this on the table. Is there a second? Second. Is there any explanation?
The town manager doesn't desire to be lynched tonight. I will give the body an update versus what I wrote a month ago or so, very optimistically. Financially, the project is not finished. I am as certain as I can be standing here that we have enough funds, but as is the case at the end of a project, we're using some very bad language and having some very loud discussions as we wrap this up. The last meeting we had 10 days ago resulted in me and our team storming out of our own room in town hall. So it is a very difficult situation. I will tell you, none of you should ever oversee a large public construction project. It's a horrible thing. I'll give a lot of credit to the permanent building committee that's come forward to do that in the future. And again, I'm as certain as I can be tonight that we have the funds that we need to finish this project. Just getting there is not easy.
Okay, we have a motion to lay this on the table. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries, the article is laid on the table. Business under Article 11, Mr. LaLasher.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Again, for those town meeting members that are newer, in Reading we tend to take care of our water and sewer infrastructure very well, far better than most communities. There's a cost to that. We have high water rates, high sewer rates. We also don't have, I should never say we're not going to have unexpected emergencies, because that'll happen right now. But we do a pretty good job. A few years back, 3 or 4 years back, we laid out a replacement plan for, I can't remember, it's 10 or 12 sewer stations. I sort of think it's 12 in the town, with a cost. We then went out to bid, and the first one came in 80% higher than we expected. And it turns out that no one had actually done sewer station rehab work in 10 years in this area. So people made stuff up, numbers up, and I mean people, I mean consultants. We rejiggered the capital plan. The sewer station rehabs were meant to be done in 10 or 12 years. This is clearly not going to happen without bankrupting all of our water sewer payers. So we spread it out over a much longer period of time. There are 10 remaining sewer station projects. The one in front of you tonight is specifically for the corner of Charles and Haverhill. This is the largest one. This by itself serves almost 1,000 residents, 1,000 homes. You can see behind me the situation. It's not a particularly good shape. We have added quite a large contingency cushion to this number, so it should work out. When Haverhill Charles was first priced, it was much closer to $1.25 million. So that's order of magnitude of how much prices have gone up. We now have experience with rehabbing two sewer stations. Earlier tonight, you saw the request for an additional $200,000. Again, I don't think we'll need that, so we're actually, knock on wood, going to come in on budget on that. That being the case, if we don't run into anything really unusual in this location, the $2.4 million should also do it for this. This is the only sewer station project planned for the next few years. Ratepayers just can't honestly afford to do more. We would prefer to do sewer station rehabs without borrowing money. $2.4 million in 1 year is too much to ask ratepayers to pay, so we have chosen to spread this out. When the debt on this project is finished, as you can see in the sewer capital plan, most, if not all, of the rest of the sewer stations will be done one at a time as capital.
FinCom report, Mr. Neshat.
At our meeting on March 22nd, 2017, the Finance Committee voted 9-0-0 to recommend this article.
Further discussion? Mr. Mon.
Jamie Mon, Precinct 4, and I think I'm strongly in favor of this, but I have some questions. First one, a clarification. I thought we discussed earlier the rehab of the Batch Elder and the West Street pump stations.
That's currently going on right now.
But you said this was the only one.
Well, the one going on right now, except for the $200,000 you just approved, has been paid for. This is the only new funds that we're going to request for a period of, I think it's 3 or 4 years. It's in the capital plan.
So West Street and Batch Elder are under design right now, correct?
It's actually under repair. It is almost complete.
Okay, thank you. Does the current Charles Street station have backup power?
Yes. Well, it will need temporary backup power as it's being worked on. Let me put it that way.
No, but I mean right now,
no.
Is there a generator, if electric power to that?
Oh, yes, there is a generator.
There is a generator.
I'm going to say all of our sewer stations have that. It may be that one or two small ones
good,
do not.
Well, that's good, because it's a state requirement that they do, so I'm glad to hear that.
If I was wrong, it was DPW's fault.
And also, you say in the backup, in the background, that this is a failing station. Has it actually failed? Has it actually shut down?
No, it has not.
So it's not actually failed?
It's very close.
So we have not had sewage released?
No. Again, that's the difference between Reading and some other communities. When we get nervous, it's because something might be going bad, not because it already has by any means.
Okay. Are we eligible for an MWRA grant to offset some of this cost?
They have said no, because we're already maxed out on our INI loans, interest-free loans from them.
Well, since you brought it up, will this revised, upgraded pump station rehab address any of our infiltration or INI issues?
My understanding is very little. It's actually the sewer pipes that need to be rehabbed to do the bulk of that work, but I would suppose there's some.
And final question. I'll finish boring everyone with this one. Are we increasing the capacity and or the storage of this station with this $2.4 million rehab?
I believe that's the case in all of our sewer stations, but not a large amount. Most of the land is built out pretty well. But yeah, we're increasing it 10%, something at the margin.
Thank you very much.
Further discussion? Yes, in the back.
Tom Grant, Precinct 4. Just given the size of this, this debt that's being raised, and your comment previously on managing a large project, obviously this isn't as large as the library. I'm just curious who's going to be managing this project, and the fact that this station's lasted 50 years, we just want to make sure it lasts us another 50 years, given the size. And just a little more clarity on how it's being run, who's project manager.
I guarantee you the town manager will not be allowed anywhere near this. This will be fully under the care and custody of the DPW and specifically the engineers who actually know what they're doing.
Further discussion? Yes.
Kevin Breer, Precinct 3. This is just a question. When you say $2.4 million in debt, does that mean we're actually going to float debt to pay for this? Or?
Yes.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Herrick.
Steve Herrick, Precinct 8. So, just from my understanding, this debt is, the intent here is this would be fully covered by water and sewer rates, or is there any portion of this that actually goes back to the town?
Fully by water, well, by sewer rates. Anticipated to issue $2.4 million for 8 years, so, you know, $300,000 plus interest.
Is there an estimated impact on the sewer rates that we think was going to result as this, or is this something that's been accommodated in our capital budget?
It's the selectmen have already voted water and sewer rates for next December. That's part of that vote.
So it's for at least for next December, that's already, it's already covered.
Yeah, if you look at page 205, 206, 7, this project is estimated to be $370,000 in FY18 capital plus, principal plus interest. The sewer budget's about $6 million, so that gives you an idea what proportion it is.
Okay, thank you.
Further discussion? Yes.
George Pizza, Precinct 2. I have a question about capacity in general. Are we building to anticipate growth?
Yes, but it depends on the locations and it depends on how much. I'll pick on one of our neighbors, North Reading, just because they're not here. We're working with them to try to get MWRA water there. They have businesses dying to come to North Reading, but there's no water and sewer. We have water and sewer and nowhere to put the businesses. You would think it would be a match. We have really good capacity. For instance, as I understand it, the 40B down by the train station, we already had adequate sewer coverage for them. So it would have to be a remarkable new development for us not to have sewer coverage. And if that's the case, the developer will pay for that.
So right now we're operating at, you know, enough capacity. I don't know. I'm in IT, yeah. So I call it N plus one. So yeah. If we lose one, we can continue operating?
Yes. Yep.
Further discussion? Yes. Mr. Sasso.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. John Sasso, Precinct 2. Just a quick question, and I was going back looking at the budget here. For FY18, it looks like you're using almost $500,000 in offset to bring the rate in, and obviously the debt for this project, if you look on the next page, you know, we're heading up towards the $800,000, $900,000. So, I mean, I don't know if that's, I don't think that's sustainable. So I guess the question is there a plan to mitigate that, or is that something that's being taken into consideration moving forward?
Water and sewer specifically require and allow themselves to be planned really well for many years into the future. That doesn't mean unexpected things don't happen. I don't remember what the sewer reserves are. I know it's in the book. It's a big number. It's $3 or $4 million. So the selectmen easily, to ameliorate rates, have the ability to use $500,000, $250,000 as needed. What we try to do when we plan, and I'll try not to bore you with too much information here, the one wild card is the MWRA's cost. We don't know that. For the sewer fund specifically, that's a big percent. It's almost 3/4 of the sewer budget. So we have to allow flexibility between reserves and capital planning, including debt, to manage around a year where the MWRA has a large increase, unless we just want to pass that along to consumers. But if the MWRA went up 10%, as they have discussed in recent years, that's a year we would want to do much less debt or capital. That's why my preference is strongly to do capital, because once you've issued debt, it's there. You have to pay for it. So yes, the debt we've issued has been done carefully. It's going to have to be paid off as it's scheduled. We can't pay it off early. We do have reserves to help pay for that. The long and short of the MWRA rate is going to be that one way or the other, we're going to have to pay what they charge us.
And just a quick follow-up. So, yeah, I mean, it does look like you've, as far as the debt is concerned, you're ramping up to about, like I said, $800 to $1 million on an annual basis moving forward. Obviously, some of that's dependent on when projects phase in and out. Again, that's page 207 in the back here. So I'm assuming you have some flexibility, and I guess that's the question. And so we just talked about the Charles Haverhill Street need, and you do have the other 10 or 12 stations listed here. Are they in similar condition, or are they closer to or better for further out, or what's the assessment on those at this point?
As of now, they're in substantially better physical condition. There's no urgent need. It's really a financial planning tool that has Sturgis starting in FY21. It's the next station that should be done. If it can't be done that year because of financial pressures, we put it off 2 or 3 years. Not going to make any difference, knock on wood.
All right.
And the question you raise about $800,000 or more in debt, that's specifically going to be in FY21 if and when we redo the water and sewer meters. That's a big number. So that number in that year is $2.6 million to do sewer station work and meters. Meters are $850,000. So again, that's not issued yet. That's things we plan around. We'll see what the MWRA charges us and move things around as we need to.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Further discussion? Are we ready for the vote? This requires a 2/3 vote, but we'll try a hand count first. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And the motion carries unanimously. Business under Article 12. Mr. Arena moves that we lay the substance of Article 12 on the table. Is there a second? Second? Do we have an explanation?
The Retirement Board chose to postpone this article due to the financial circumstances of the town not wanting to ask for anything that caused additional funding to be needed.
Okay, we have a motion to lay it on the table. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries, and it's laid on the table. Business under Article 13, Ms. Angstrom.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This article is to close the sick vacation buyback fund that we have. It was established back in 2009 with the intent of funding these liabilities annually at town meeting. But there was never enough annual funding that we could put in there to really get ahead of the liability. So we ended up reverting back to pay-as-you-go because we just couldn't put enough in there to ever keep any balance in there. And this fund was basically used for vacation buybacks. So any employee that actually leaves the town and has accrued any vacation time, we would actually pay it out, obviously. And a lot of times that isn't what we'd use it for, because a lot of times if somebody left the town, there's usually vacancies, and so there's room in the operating budget for that. But we would use it if we needed to, if somebody had a lot of vacation time. The sick is where we'd use most of it. The sick leave has been pretty much eliminated for most employees and was years ago, but at that time, some were grandfathered in who had 20 plus years of service. And then we don't pay it out until somebody retires, and often we don't know when somebody's going to retire in time to budget for that accordingly in the annual budget. So you frequently will see us ask for that funding at a November town meeting so that we can, you know, accurately get those numbers down. And so this fund never really fulfilled its purpose, where we were able to accumulate funds to draw on as the needs were, you know, coming to us. And so we're looking to close it and just revert back to pay as you go, because it just wasn't working out that we could save money in this fund so that we could cover these liabilities as they came up.
FinCom report, Ms. Landry.
At our meeting on March 22nd, 2017, the Finance Committee voted 9-0-0 to recommend this article.
Further discussion? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tony DiRezzo, Precinct 2. I noticed it said that sick leave buyback is no longer available, but it's still vacation buyback still available.
Yeah, you can't take that away. If they've accrued vacation time, you have to pay it out. But like I said, we tend to be able to cover that with our operating budget, because when somebody leaves, we tend to have vacancy for a period of time trying to fill that position. So a lot of times that isn't what we're asking for. Most of the time it was the sick leave, because they get maximum of 100 days at 50% of their pay. So that number tends to be a lot larger and not able to be easily absorbed in the operating budget. But like I said, so few people actually still qualify for this. You'd have to have been, at the time we were phasing it out, at 20 plus years. So we're talking people with a lot of years in at the time that we phased it out.
But the vacation time back is still available. Would it make more sense to buy back the vacation time each year as opposed to allowing it to accumulate?
Well, we only are allowed to accumulate, you know, carry over so many weeks. So vacation time doesn't tend to be a large number of weeks, because you're only able to carry over 1 week or 2 weeks, and so it doesn't end up being as large of a number. It doesn't end up being an issue, as big of an issue as the sick leave tends to be.
Thank you.
Further discussion? None appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 14, Ms. Delios.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Article 14 is the article about the Affordable Housing Trust Fund, and this is an allocation plan that requires town meeting action annually. As the background describes, the Affordable Housing Trust Fund was established under Chapter 140 of the Acts of 2001, and the fund is a resource that can be used to produce new or preserve existing affordable housing. The current balance is $262,634, and the funds can be used with a limitation of a 5% max up to $10,000 on administration. And the rest of the funds can be used for either new affordable housing, that would be housing that would be developing units through loans or grants, preserving existing affordable housing, maintaining or improving affordable housing that currently exists, or converting units to affordable housing, purchasing housing and adding to it or maintaining it on the affordable housing inventory. Thank you.
FinCom report, Mr. Doxer.
Mr. Moderator, at our meeting on March 22nd, 2017, Finance Committee voted 9-0-0 to recommend this article.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Meyer.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jamie Vaughn, Precinct 4. Just a question. In the background description of this article, there's the phrase, "This effort is important as a defense against unfriendly 40B developments." Can you explain what you mean by unfriendly 40B developments?
Oxymoron.
That's exactly what I'm afraid of.
No, what this fund is meant to be, it's meant to be a resource for the town to be proactive about affordable housing, not reactive.
I understand that, and I support it fully. I just want to know what you mean by unfriendly 40B development.
Just that.
Unfriendly to whom? Unfriendly to the people that want to live in those houses?
40B tends to be friendly 40B and unfriendly 40B.
And if you could just define those, please.
Sure. Friendly 40B is when, in many cases, communities have already reached their 10%, and there's an ability for them, for a developer to come in and work collaboratively with the town. We refer to that as a friendly 40B. The town and the developer are collaborating in bringing affordable housing to the community, many times in communities that have long achieved the required 10%, so they're not subject to. Otherwise, you can talk to anybody on the planet about a 40B, and I've spent the better part of three decades dealing with this. Nothing about it is friendly. These 40Bs that come in, and anybody that's been involved in the one down at the train station, was long, difficult, and painful to just get through the process. Hopefully we're better now than we were when we started, but I'd call that unfriendly 40B.
Further discussion? Yes, Ms. O'Neill.
Mary Ellen O'Neill, Precinct 4. Just a quick question in terms of, have we done anything with this trust fund in the years that we've had it, and could you give a couple examples, or are we wanting to wait till we reach a certain amount to do something? Thank you.
Sure. Since I've been here, we've had one project that has benefited from these funds, and that's 30 Haven Street. And the amount was $200,000. That's all that I'm aware of, at least in the 8 years that I've been here, that has been dipped into for the fund.
Yes, Mr. O'Rourke.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Tom O'Rourke, Precinct 2. Could you clarify, do you know what percentage of 40B housing we currently have?
8.49.
Approximately. Thank you.
Approximately.
Further discussion? Yes, in the back. Mr. Grant.
Tom Grant, Precinct 4. I just want to thank you for all the background you provide in the booklets here. Sometimes that raises more questions. So in reading about this, it seems like a plan was established, was received by the Board of Selectmen in April 2013, but then it's not clear to me why nothing was done against it, or maybe something there was done against it.
Oh, yes.
And I so
can,
that, well,
do
so
you have about 3 hours? I can go through the whole plan.
I really, really, no, I really don't want that. But
this stuff.
It started making me wonder if we have what one might consider an unfriendly 40B development now, could it have been prevented with this plan, or is this plan not what I think it might be based on the description?
Sure.
And then going forward, you know, to have an unrestricted $262,000, what's the plan for that?
Okay, let me start with the easy question first. What town meeting is being asked tonight is to approve this allocation plan. There really isn't a plan for it, but it basically allows the town to be able to be proactive and to be able to use the money should there be something that comes up. We don't have any plan right now for it. We do have an affordable housing plan. And that plan went through a very extensive year-and-a-half process of public meetings, demographic analysis, presentations to the Board of Selectmen. It was a very detailed, what's called, housing production plan. The reason we went to that great extent to create a housing production plan was because, by doing that, the town demonstrates its commitment to meeting the state mandate of 10% affordable housing. We don't just say we have a plan for it, we have a production plan, which means we have a way of getting there. And back in 2012, 5 years ago, we looked in the crystal ball and said, this is how we can get to 10%. And that was really what the plan was about, and that's what the state expects us to do. They expect us to be at 10%. If we're not at 10%, they want to know how we're going to get there. So that's what the plan is. we have made significant strides. We're at 8.49. That's the highest, I think, on record for the town of Reading. I just gave a presentation Thursday night to the Board of Selectmen explaining exactly where we are now on the subsidized housing inventory and the fact that we have, as the town manager pointed out, several more 40Bs in the queue, various stages of approval. And the one that was just filed, which is on the website, is 160 units. And with that one and the one on Woburn Street, we begin to now just tip over 10%. And the reason that's significant is because it demonstrates that we have been proactive and we have been moving the ball forward to achieve this. A footnote to that is that another reason why we did the housing production plan is because if we can prove to the state that we provide either 0.5 or 1% in a one-year period, the state gives us basically a stay, or they call it a certification. So we just achieved that in February. So right now, the town of Reading has a one-year basic moratorium. It's not really what it is, but for lack of a better term, basically a hold or a stay on any 40Bs. Now you say, the next question, what do you mean? You just said somebody just filed for a 40B. How can you say that, you know, we're not doing that anymore for the next year? Well, the reason is because with the way the state looks at it, the developer applies to the state for the 40B, and the state can say, yeah, it looks good to us, and then bring it back to the town, and it goes before the Zoning Board of Appeals. And the Zoning Board of Appeals, at this point, can, within a certain time frame after opening the public hearing, can exercise the option of saying, we are certified, we don't have to hear this application. Or they can work with the developer and go through the process and have the public hearings and, you know, take it from there.
Thank you.
Want to keep going?
Not really.
Further discussion? Not appearing. We're ready for the vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed, and the motion carries. Business under Article 15, Ms. Angstrom.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. This article is to authorize the spending for the revolving funds that fall under Section 53E and a half of Chapter 44. And on the slide you see behind me are the revolving funds that we have been doing each year, and the spending limits have not changed.
FinCom report, Mr. McNeese.
At our meeting on March 22nd, 2017, the Finance Committee voted 9-0-0 in favor of the article.
Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. Inspection Revolving Fund. I believe this is where our new economic development person is being paid from. Am I correct?
You are correct.
I see nothing in the allocated funds allowed expenses that says that. How are we doing it? Because there's nothing in here that tells me that we can do that.
Bob's saying it's part of the bylaw, but I believe we had voted it at town meeting prior. Because any one of these funds can be used for any purpose, I believe, with town meeting approval.
By what?
By town meeting approval.
Okay.
As long as it's clearly stated what we're using it for.
Thank you. I'd like to offer an amendment then. I'd like to cut this to 100,000 instead of 200,000.
Is there a second to that? Second.
No seconds.
Okay. Discussion?
No seconds. Okay. Fine.
Yes, there's a second.
There was? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. In all due respect to our new economic development person, I met him. I think he's a heck of a guy. But quite frankly, we have spent thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars and many, many, many hours to get economic development in this town. and NIMBY has killed most of it. So I don't want to spend thousands of dollars more, come to town meeting, and have NIMBY nix it. Thank you.
Okay, right now we all discussion is on the amendment, the proposed amendment. Mr. LaLasher.
I'd just like to say that I don't recall the town spending any money until this recent effort on economic development. We did have a volunteer economic development committee, and I suppose they handled money in some smaller fashion, but this is the first effort in the 19 or 20 years I've been involved in town meeting that I remember the town actually spending money in this way.
Okay, further discussion on the proposed amendment? None appearing. All those in favor of reducing, oh, do you have a, reducing the amount from 200,000 to 100,000. Where is that exactly? It's inspection development.
Just to explain to town meeting, I don't remember exactly what the total use in the budget on next Monday night was, but I'll say it's 200,000. I think it's less. If this amendment passes, the town will need to either cut $100,000 out of its budget or ask for $100,000 in free cash. And the whole purpose of economic development was to tie economic development funds with an economic development future effort at revenue.
Okay, so it's the inspection revolving fund. We've reduced it from 200,000 to 100,000 if this should carry. Further discussion on that proposed amendment? Not appearing. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion does not carry. Further discussion on the main motion? Not appearing. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. Oh, we had a, excuse me, we had somebody? Oh, sorry, Ms. Young.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Megan Young, Precinct 4. I just had a question, because in the notes it says that the town manager is requesting $190,000, and it says $200,000 on the top. So I was just wondering what the difference was.
I think the $190,000 that's referred to is how much is actually being used in fiscal 18's operating budget, but they can use up to $200,000.
All right, so he's identified 190 and that there's 10 that we're authorizing that he could use, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. And then on the question before, it said allowed expenses, because you said that we as a body could vote on anything, but it says in here, in the table, allowed expenses are specific.
But they're specific without your authorization. But if we're going to use it for something that's outside of what we lay out on that warrant, we would need to bring it before you, and
okay,
it need to be voted by town meeting.
Because I actually read it like public service planning and general management would be actually covered for the position. I don't know. I just thought that made sense.
Bob is saying I'm incorrect in my understanding that we actually can't do it for any purpose. These ones are different.
Okay, so that it is specific, and I'm assuming that it is under public service planning and general management that this falls under. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Great. Thank you very much.
Further discussion? None appearing? Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 16. Mr. Arena moves that we lay Article 16 on the table. The reason for this, by the way, is we plan on taking this up 1 week from tonight. Is there a second? Second? All those in favor of laying Article 16 on the table, please raise your hand. Those opposed, the motion carries. Business under Article 17, Ms. Angstrom.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The purpose of this article is to authorize borrowing in anticipation of Chapter 90 and to accept any funding that's earmarked for Reading for Chapter 90 for funding for fiscal 18. It looks like right now we're looking at 594-103. It also should be noted that we've never really had to borrow in anticipation of the Chapter 90 funding, but it's just kind of the standard protocol of the way it's voted.
FinCom report, Mr. Leidecker.
At the FinCom meeting held on March 22nd, the committee voted 9-0 with no abstentions to recommend the article.
Any further discussion? None appearing. This requires a two-thirds vote, but we will try a hand count first. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries unanimously. Business under Article 18. Stepler? Mr. Alasha, you?
Is there Greg Stepler in the house, I hope? Uh-oh. Well, I'll try. Oh, there he is. Let me just take a moment to say that the Permanent Building Committee is one of the greatest assets this town has formed. I haven't been able to meet logistically with them in 2 or 3 months, but they really are an outstanding group, and I feel very comfortable that they'll have an oversight over the buildings in the future. And now Greg will do the article instead of me. Thank you.
Mr. Stepler.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I think that the text of the article, the information that was included in the packet, pretty much lays out for the most part the consensus, the building committee, the revisions we wanted to make to the bylaw. Most basically, it was to take some of the expertise that we have on the committee itself and the language of the bylaw and update it to what we felt really was the mission that town meeting expects of us, and that is the application of our expertise professionally to the betterment of the town as an objective body to evaluate, analyze, and provide feedback to the town on building projects.
Set. Bylaw committee report, Mr. Struble.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Jeff Struble, Chairman of the Bylaw Committee. At our meeting last Tuesday on the 18th, April 18th, with the language you see in the printout you got today, which was the sort of final rehash of one sentence in one of the paragraphs, we voted to recommend the content of this article by a vote of 4-0-0.
Thank you. Further discussion? Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Bill Brown, Precinct 8. And I echo the sentiments of the town manager. I think they're a great bunch of people on the building committee. However, I don't think they do a good job in writing bylaws. But whatever. Hi, Greg. I think this is not a bad bylaw. The one problem I do have with it is the sponsoring agencies, as it spells out in there. It only allows the three elected bodies to be sponsoring agencies. It does not allow for this body to be a sponsoring agency. Therefore, I feel that they're taking our right and the citizens' right under the charter to bring an article to the floor of town meeting and eventually have the building committee do it. There's a couple of little things in here that to me are incidental, but no, overall I think it's a good bylaw, and I think you got a good committee, Greg. And having served as one of the temporary members, hopefully we'll get a cemetery building someday.
Further discussion? Not appearing. Are we ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Those opposed? And the motion carries. Business under Article 19. Mr. Safina. Mr. Lalasha?
Sorry.
Mr. Safina. Oh, okay.
On Monday, February 13th, 2017, CPDC convened to hold a public hearing on the proposed Article 19. All documents were made available on the town website. Public hearing was held to provide an opportunity for comment and to determine whether the provisions of the proposed zoning bylaw amendment shall be adopted by the town. The February 13th, 2017 public hearing was opened at approximately 8 p.m. Any comments received at the hearing were included as part of the record of the hearing. On February 13th, the hearing was closed. The CPDC voted 4 0-0 to recommend the Article 19 to town meeting.
Okay. Do we have a presentation?
Yes.
Okay.
About a year ago or so, we went through and made a lot of changes to the zoning bylaw, including changing some tables along with the in what could be done for accessory apartments. As with any regulation, it takes a little while to really understand how that plays out. And one of the things that came about was some issues related to accessory uses and specifically accessory apartments on a building lot. And so what we found in the way that the zoning bylaw had been drafted and passed was that it was a little more permissive in terms of detached structures than both the CPDC and the Board of Selectmen really wanted it to be. What it was allowing to have happen is a detached building be built right up in front of the property, right up along the, right in, almost in front of the house, and really be able to change the character of a neighborhood. And I don't think that's what anyone was, the intent was to begin with when we made that change. What we wanted to do was allow a detached structure for an accessory apartment to be made to, you know, so that we could have those in town, change the mix of housing, but not really do so in a way that changes the character of anyone's neighborhood. And so in order to do that, what we did was a couple of things. One was we changed on this slide here. We changed the who the applicant came in front of from the ZBA to CPDC on detached structures because CPDC typically deals with site plans and those sorts of detached, you know, the whole site types of issues. Did the same thing. We had a specific line item there for a carriage house, stable, and barn, so we changed that as well. And it was also shown that, identified that in the table that we weren't allowing accessory apartments in A40 districts, and that didn't quite make sense. There's only a couple of those in town, and those actually are a district that is more fitting to accessory apartments. And so what we also did, is this the right slide? Does this presentation have like all the pictures? Yeah. And so what you'll see also in your in the handout are some graphical representations of what we intended and what we're looking at and establishing what's termed as no building zone. It's that area between the front of the house in the street, and what you'll see here in red. So okay to have the building built back behind the front of the building, but in this case where the front of the building would be up in front of that the front line of the house, that would not be permitted. Again, what we one to make sure is that we accommodated every sort of every possible configuration of a house. There's, you know, where the house goes in and out. So we created these other graphics to explain what that no building zone is, with the whole idea that we don't want to have any accessory apartment structures out in front of the house changing the neighborhood.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. John Arena, Precinct 1. The Board of Selectmen voted 5-0 in favor of this particular article, largely out of the first instance of the accessory apartments yielding the very circumstance that Mr. Weston described. So it's a little case of unforeseen circumstances. The article tonight is an attempt to address what we've learned and meet the original intent of the accessory apartment language. Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, Mr. Daddario.
Ron Daddario, Precinct 6. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The one kind of concern I had, excuse me, is on page 23 in the original in our warrant. On the bottom of the page, and it talks about that no special permit for an accessory apartment shall be issued unless the SPGA, the sponsoring, whether it's the CPDC, I guess, or the zoning board, finds that the exterior appearance of the accessory apartment and any accessory structure, et cetera, I will maintain the essential character of the neighborhood, and on it goes. So, I mean, my concern, I mean, the question I have is when the house went up, originally, it didn't have to go, I don't believe it went in front of a board to see if the house itself was in the essential character of the neighborhood. At least I don't think that's true. So, I just have a little problem that you have to go in front of a board and to make sure, and what is the board going to use? I mean, what criterion? And is the board qualified to make that decision as to whether it fits architecturally? It seems like I'm just not comfortable with it. I mean, I realize that we don't want to have a circus tent or some real crazy design. And yet, I look at the town and say, I don't believe we've had this rule before, and the town seems to have done fairly well. So I would just say that I would like to see that paragraph just taken out.
Actually, sort of throughout the zoning bylaw, there are different areas where changes to structures need to be done within the character of the community. That's really one of a lot of what the Zoning Board of Appeals deals with. And one of the things that they, right, that's one of the standards that they need to uphold on most of the things that they look at. So that's really not all that much of a departure of some of the things that are done on a regular basis. I guess what's different with this is that it really is front and foremost in allowing a special permit. I think, Gene, there were some specific, specific criteria. There are this whole, too many to read, but there's this whole set of performance standards that the board is supposed to look at in terms of trying to decide of whether it fits in with the character or not. So it's not just the board's feeling, oh, I like that, I like that, that's pink, I don't like pink, or whatever. I mean, there's some standards that were put together so that it's not just, I guess, can I use the term willy-nilly?
So it's already in place. I didn't realize this is already being done. I mean, prior to this, the zoning board
using neighborhood character as a standard. Yes.
All right. Thank you.
Further discussion? Yes, Ms. Binda.
Angela Binda, Precinct 5. I have some questions. I was a little confused reading some of this, and I noticed that in the big warrant that we have on page, that is page 20, under the table 532, there are some crossouts and bolds which indicate changes, but then in the motion it looks like it went back to what you originally had. And I don't remember the difference between SPA and SPP.
You're absolutely correct. So let me explain something. I actually didn't realize this. I wasn't planning on making this presentation.
Can you just explain?
I stepped in. SPA is the ZBA, the Zoning Board of Appeals.
SPA is ZBA, and
SPP
is
planning.
CPDC.
Yes.
Okay.
So what was, last thing I knew was going to happen was that there was going to be a friendly motion be put on after I made my presentation of suggesting having the ZBA maintain control of this. And not CPDC. Unbeknownst to me, that was included in the motion that you see.
Okay, what's the reasoning behind?
So what I explained to you, yeah, so typically CPDC deals with site plans. They deal with, you know, how buildings sit on a property, look at the whole property, how it all fits in. And after this went to print, there was some discussion, and it was felt that that it made more sense for consistency for an applicant that if anything to do with accessory apartments, whether it was an attached apartment or a detached apartment, that it all stay with one board, and that the appropriate board would be ZBA.
Would be ZBA.
Yes.
Okay.
And so CPDC, we had that discussion, and we knew that motion was going to be made and had no issues with that.
Okay.
Thank you for catching that, because I didn't.
another question that I have. So in the existing bylaw table of use, it seems there's some clarity in the way that it's written, attached accessory apartment contained within existing single-family dwelling, attached accessory apartment with a new construction, detached accessory apartment with existing, and detached apartment with new construction. So there seems to be, and I'm looking at page 34 of the existing zoning bylaw, and if you change the language as you have suggested, it seems to, rather than clarify it, make it a little more ambiguous, because what you're on the motion thing, 532 table of uses, where you have detached accessory apartment, not in a barn, existing carriage house, stable, or barn, and you cross out associated with new construction of a single family. But that's very similar to the one that appears like right above it, which is detached accessory apartment associated with existing single family dwelling. And this is detached accessory apartment of a single family dwelling. So you have like two places on the accessory uses. And one of them, this one you're adding, not an existing carriage house or barn, But then does that imply that the other one isn't it? I don't think it is. But I think that by doing this, you're actually making it more ambiguous. You're making your accessory use table more.
So we had to pull out the detached within a carriage house, stable, or barn, because there's a whole nother section of ZB of the bylaw that deals with how to treat carriage houses, stables, and barns. So we didn't want to, we would be at cross purposes there. But I think the way that we have this, so we just have one category where it's detached, one category where it's the carriage house, stable, or barn, and then the two sections of attached, whether it's attached within the structure of the existing building or whether there's an addition. So I don't disagree that it would be a way to make it simpler, but we need to have all those different protections.
Okay, but are you saying that this, what you have right here, is going to go instead of this? Because that's not what the motion says. I mean, you have the new language in bold and the cross-out language being crossed out. So you actually have a couple of categories for detached and a couple of categories for attached, which makes it like you're adding this in. This is still here. So you don't just have one detached category, one attached category. So you're kind of repeating it and making it more ambiguous.
Yeah. So there's two detached and two attached columns, right? And maybe is the confusion that the attached are separated out?
Well, the
one
I
can see that.
The confusion is that one of them is called detached accessory apartment associated with new detached accessory apartment of a single family dwelling, and one of them is called detached accessory apartment associated with an existing single family dwelling, which is kind of almost the same. And if you add in not in a barn, does it imply that the other one is?
Mr. Mayaris?
Well, let's try some instant drafting. I think what you
think that Mr. Mayaris maybe, oh, do you have a point yourself? Okay, go ahead.
Tom Wise, Precinct 3. If I think what you're asking is this versus that, which is 531 versus 532,
no,
is that what you're asking?
No, I'm asking existing versus the motion.
Okay, so you're suggesting that because it says amending instead of replacing, that this is going to add these new categories on top of what's already there.
No, that's not what I'm saying at all. I'm saying that what is in bold will be added, and what is crossed out will be deleted.
Okay. But you still have an attached, a detached.
I'm sorry, can I?
Okay, sorry.
Ms. Binder, you have the floor.
Thank you.
Thought maybe there was a chance, there was an explanation there.
Do you,
okay,
have a copy? Do you have a copy of the existing?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so what I think you're asking for is for that second line, left box to say detached accessory apartment associated with a single family dwelling so that it is parallel to what the corresponding provision that's in the business district.
Detached accessory apartment of a single family dwelling.
No.
Detached accessory apartment associated with an existing single family dwelling. What's the difference? What's the difference?
What do you mean by what's the difference?
Well, because that category already exists in the table. Right, but you're crossing out the new construction. You're crossing it out. One of them is associated with new construction, but
sorry,
you're...
I was talking about
one speaker at a time, please. Ms. Binda. We have, Ms. Binder's got the floor, and we have an answer here, please.
When we're talking about a detached accessory apartment, we don't think that it matters whether the principal single family dwelling is new construction or not. That's why we took that out.
So it's a detached accessory apartment of a single family dwelling.
It's associated with a single family dwelling.
Detached accessory apartment associated with an existing single-family dwelling?
Well, we don't care if the single-family dwelling is new construction or not, so whether it's existing or not.
Right, but that's already a category.
Okay.
So that's what I'm asking, because that category already exists.
So the two detached accessory apartment categories are the two in the middle.
But there's one in the existing bylaw that you don't have here.
She's saying because this category is detached.
And it doesn't appear that you've stricken it anywhere.
Okay, that's a good point. But so the intention was to replace that category.
Okay, but it's not actually stricken anywhere on your...
That is correct.
Mayaris.
Okay, so I think I finally understand what you're saying, which is there is another line that is not referenced in this motion. By the time you change this second line the way that you're talking about, you've essentially made it the same as one that's two above.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Okay. So how do we fix that? It's your intention to do that, right? Okay. So, the obvious thing to do is to delete the prior one, since you've now made...
It does have different
entries in the boxes, yes. That's what I was just noticing,
yeah,
is that
one
is SPA, no, and the other
yeah,
is would be SPA and SPA.
Right.
So So the intention is to change it. So you should delete the one, we should delete the one that is inconsistent. So, Mr. Moderator, this will call for a ruling as to whether that's within the four corners.
It's, I believe it is, because it's that was what the intention was. So I would allow that, even though it's slightly out of the area that we're changing, but it seems like that was what the intention was.
Well, it's a better result than ending up with two lines that are inconsistent.
Correct.
With each
right,
other.
Right. So okay. Do we have a motion, a proposed amendment?
Do you want me to, I don't know, what would a motion? A motion to strike that whole line?
Yeah, I think it has to be dealt
with. What was that, excuse me?
It would be a motion to delete from this table.
Just a second, Mr. Brown. Go ahead. While he's doing that, Mr. Brown, your point of order?
There seems to be an awful lot of confusion. Would it be improper to lay this on the table till Thursday night and let the people work out on the outside and bring it back so we can clearly understand it?
Do we have a motion to lay this on the table?
Can I bring up another point before we do that?
Well, we have a motion to lay it on the table, which is non-debatable. And a second? Second. Okay, motion to lay this on the table. All those in favor, please raise your hand. And those opposed? The motion carries. This is laid on the table. Mr. Arena? Okay, we have a motion to adjourn, but before I accept a second on that, I just want to remind you, try to get here on time for 7:30. We have a special guest coming. And we have a second for that motion. Second. All those in favor of adjournment until Thursday evening, please raise your hand. Those opposed, motion carries. This town meeting stands adjourned.